Good morning, church. It is good to be with you this morning. Happy Mother's Day. Yay! It is so fun. It has been a really interesting week in different things where I have been in and out of different circumstances and places, and I was running in to pick something up at HEB, and as I'm like just going around to like grab some fruit or whatever, and I'm over by the flower section, and I hear this, like, what I assume is a father and son. They're walking by, and the little boy goes, "Wait, Mom, Sunday!" So I'm like, ah, good, it's on everyone's radar. So it is good to be with you this morning. It is a joy and a blessing, and it is my gift to be the pastor here at Edinburgh First United Methodist Church, and my joy to welcome you into a time of worship. As we gather this morning, just a couple of thank yous. One, we had Market Day yesterday, and so thank you for the people who come and support and shop and buy, and for the people who come and set up and make sure that there are spots numbered and checking in vendors. It's been a really great time. We've met some really lovely people from our neighborhood. Yesterday, we even had live music, and that was pretty fun. So make sure on our market day you come out and just see what's going on and how we are being present in yet another way in our community. Let's see. This is the second. Okay, so food pantry is not next Saturday, but the Saturday after, right? Okay, so the 21st. So put that on your radar. We will need some help on the 21st for food pantry to assemble bags and then to distribute. Like looking up, okay, good. I was like, is there something on the screen that I have messed up? I just assume I've given bad information. So if you will put that on your radar for the food pantry and be able to help. If you did not, ladies, get some chocolate from Dana as you walked in the door, she has a ginormous basket. I won't make her wander the aisles. But to make sure our token of appreciation to you for the way you have loved and nurtured the people in your life, and something sweet for the sweet. And I think that is all of our announcements before we go into this, as we begin our time of worship. I know you all saw the Keurigs and the treats and all that good stuff. If you need a Keurig tutorial, there are many of us well skilled in that, and we will be happy to show you. Please feel free to bring your coffee in and be at home. This is our home, and we are family, and so be at peace and be at rest. If you are joining us online, a special welcome and a special happy Mother's Day. I invite you to start passing the peace on the thread, a blessing of one to another in the grace and peace of Jesus Christ, so much more than good morning or hello. If you are joining us here in person, I invite you to take out your smartphone, check in on our Facebook page, bless someone on that thread, begin passing the peace on the thread as well. That's one of the ways we are trying to connect our online and our in-person community. And then once you have done that, please turn with your best parade wave, make eye contact, greet each other in the peace and grace of Jesus Christ. And we will turn our thoughts and our affections to the Lord as we prepare our hearts for worship. And so as they come forward, Kayla and Jennifer will be singing our prelude this morning. And I had a moment of terror when Omar says, they sang this on their senior recital. And I was like, they're not in high school. And he had to remind me they were graduating college this week. We have so many college grads. And so this was from their senior recital. Are you graduating this week? Yeah? You're not? No? Phew, we get you for a little while longer. Okay. Senior recitals. Not that I'm, you know, planning your future or your lives or anything. And so let's turn our thoughts and our affections to the Lord as we prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you. Please stand as you are able for our call to worship. We will all read together. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you are still with me. Please remain standing for our opening song.
That may be. small, but they have seen the beauty of enormous things, which leads me to thee. There's not enough to see that you make everything glorious. You make everything glorious. You make everything glorious, and I am yours. From glory to glory, you are glorious, you are glorious. From glory to glory, you are glorious, you are glorious. Which leads me to believe why I can believe. You make everything glorious. You make everything glorious. You make everything glorious, and I am yours. You make everything glorious. You make everything glorious, and I am yours. From glory to glory, from glory to glory, you are glorious, you are glorious, you are glorious, you are glorious.
Please join me in our profession of faith. I will read the leader's portion, and you will respond with the people's portion printed in bold. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
You may be seated. We have two scriptures this morning, one from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, 15 through 19, and then from the Gospel of John, chapter 19, 25 through 27. Listen now for the word of the Lord. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in a manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. But Mary kept all these things in her heart, and she thought about them often. And then from the Gospel of John. Standing near the cross were Jesus' mother and his mother's sister, Mary, wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus, his mother, standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to his disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, this disciple took her into his home. These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. As in all things, Mother's Day, Father's Day, various celebrations have become very sensitive around certain issues. And what used to just be a no-brainer about celebrating mom, and I can still, some of my best memories are Mother's Day, and Dad has made like this crazy sort of breakfast buffet before we go to church, and there are orchids in the fridge for Mom, and he's putting one on her wrist and one on her lapel, and of course, because the girls can't be left out, my sister and I have orchids in the fridge, and I still don't understand what that was about, but and then we would go to church together, and then we would go have a late lunch together, and it was just this big day that was all about Mom, and there was pink everywhere and angel food cake and just whatever brought joy to my mom, it was in abundance in the house. And I just always thought about Mother's Day as the day we celebrate mom, our mom, with all the great things. And I want to be clear, and I'm like, well, okay, this is the danger of live streaming. Like, disclaimer to anyone who knows me and my family when you watch this, my mom was a person and she wasn't perfect and sometimes we struggled. But it didn't ever occur to me that some people didn't have that same kind of experience of their mom, and that for them, Mother's Day was hard. And then I started to, you know, I grew up and I met people in different experiences, and there were people whose children made it hard to be a mom. And any given day that you asked my mom, she would have said her children made it hard to be a mom. But then there were women who desperately wanted to be moms, and it just wasn't going to happen. For one reason or another, time, choices, biology, whatever. And they were desperate to be moms. I remember a very dear friend, and I will leave her nameless, explored every avenue. She and her husband, every conceivable avenue. And it just wasn't for them. It wasn't going to happen. Not surrogacy, not adoption, not anything. Like, it just wasn't going to work. And several of us at that time, when she was at her most heartbroken, had already been sort of scheduled and planned to go on a trip to Israel. And part of that trip was to Shiloh. And if you are not familiar with that specific town, Shiloh is where Hannah pleaded with the Lord for a child, specifically for a son. And so those of us who knew her were gathered there together, and we poured our hearts out in Shiloh for her. But there was no baby. There was no child. She is the best aunt on the face of the planet, and at any given time, her sisters and brothers' children will be found at her house when they cannot be found anywhere else. And so in a way, she mothered, but she wasn't a mom. And those of us who don't have children recognize and understand it's an awkward conversation. I can't even tell you how many times I've been asked between the ages of about 27, because about then people were like, you should be having children. And then you get to a point where people are like, oh, like they just expected that I was either putting it off or whatever. But now I'm at an age, please Lord, where there won't be children, because I tell you, having birth at 50 does not appeal to me. And they're like, well, didn't you want them? Why didn't you have them? And talk about awkward conversation that really, don't ask that question. Two questions I want you to banish from your mind and your mouth. When are you going to start having kids? And yes, ladies, do not ask that of your children about being a grandma. Stop asking that question. And then, why didn't you? Those are rough, rough questions. And so as we press into scripture about what it means to be a mom, what it looks like to be a mom, the difficulties, the blessings, I think it's perfect that we start in that place. I mean, there are many biblical moms that we should explore and look at. But let's face it, Mary, she had to deal with all of it. Like, she had a hard space. She was pregnant when she shouldn't have been. She had to face, like, she had this incredible story. No, immaculate conception. She had to face her town and her family and her people and her fiancé. And then here's Jesus, the King of the universe. And she loves him and she raises him, not just the way we expect, but with pride and with joy in a present place in the community. She doesn't hide him. She doesn't shy away. She knows who he's going to be, and she puts him and she prepares him to be who he was created and called to be. And then we look to the second scripture, because we have this example of a mom, the family we bear, the family we're born into. But we see Jesus on the cross, and he looks at his mother, and he looks at John the disciple, and you can always tell when they're referring, like, who wrote that gospel, because he doesn't say, Jesus looked at me, and he doesn't say, Jesus looked at John. He always refers to himself as the one Jesus loved. So someone who very much wanted his points as being Jesus's favorite. Jesus looks at John the disciple and says, this is your mother. Take care of my mom. Take care of my mom. And he looks at his mom and he says, this one, okay, he might be my favorite, so take care of him. Don't miss me too much. You know who I am. So take care of each other. And it occurred to me just this morning, so it's going to be like this messy break in the sermon. Jesus was not an only child. Jesus had at least two brothers recorded in scripture. Why is he looking at a disciple saying, take care of my mom? Why isn't he looking at his brothers saying, take care of our mom? But instead, he recognizes that it's not just about take care of mom, but John's going to need somebody too. There's more stuff going on than what we know or we experience. And we know that the life of the disciples after Jesus is difficult, and they're martyred, and there's mess. John, take care of my mom. You be a family now. There's the family we're born with and the family we're given. And sometimes they overlap. Sometimes they're enmeshed. You mean they're the people we know, the people we have been so a part of each other's lives forever. They are the people that have met our mom, know our mom. We knew their moms. We were in and out of each other's houses all the time. In ancient Israel, life was very different. The way you set up a home, the way you set up community, the way you set up your village. A lot of times we think right now, like, these are my kids. I'm going to discipline them the way I want, right? These are my kids. I'm responsible for X, Y, Z. If you lived in ancient Israel and you were in a village, everybody raised your kids. If you live in a small town, everybody raises your kids. Your kids can't get to you to confess faster than the people who know them can get to you to tell them what they've done. The community raises the family. Everybody has a mom, even when they don't have a mom. Everybody spends time nurturing and pouring in and loving and blessing. When we think about potential statistics of a biblical age, the two highest mortality rates are children dying in childbirth and women dying in childbirth. You are going to need your community to raise your kids. You are going to need to know that the women you went to the well with to draw water and the women that you did your everyday things and worked in the field and took care of, you needed to know that they were going to take care of your kids when you couldn't. And you were going to love them like your own. And somehow as women, I mean, men do it too, and I'll talk about you guys on Father's Day. But ladies, we were raised into an identity to take care of people. Our first thought is always to how we're taking care of people. The responsibility of that, the weight of that, the joy of that, the frustration of that. Up first in the household, to bed last in the household. Making sure there's food in the fridge. Making sure everybody's made their appointments and gotten to their ball games and gotten to their practices. And then if we're lucky, there's a chance and a time when we get to take care of our moms like that. The ones we were born with and the ones we were given. Talk about catching somebody off guard. Like, oh, no, no. There is a time to celebrate, and there is a time to return, that we live into that identity as sons and daughters that our mothers gave us. We learn from their mistakes. We learn from their successes. We're humbled, and we're grateful, and we're faithful. And even when those moms aren't the moms we wanted or hoped they'd be, they were our moms. And the truth is, every person does the best they can with what they've got. Our moms did the best they could. It was really good. Even when we didn't know it. And so if today you are a woman among us who didn't have kids of your own, maybe you didn't see that in your future, whatever the circumstance was, there are people in your community that need you to mom them. And if you don't like that word, then you can be the best aunt ever. You can be the nosy pastor who gets involved in things that maybe you aren't invited into. I call pastor privilege. There are college kids who are living away from home who need to know that they're going to be taken care of. Their parents need to trust that there is some grown-up somewhere in a church close by that's going to be watching out. There are kids whose parents are split and they don't see their mom. They need us to be that community that loves them in a way only a woman can. They're going to need dads. They're going to need men to teach them all those things that only men can teach them. There are things that only a mom can teach us. And we see the importance of that in the gospel. Mary heard all the things that the shepherds had to say, all the things that the angels had to say, all the things that the wise men, all of the gifts, all of the things, and she knew the prophecies. The angel appeared to her first, and if the angel has to say, don't be afraid, you've got good reason to be afraid. She knew what was in store for her child, and she treasured those things in her heart. And then she was given a son that wasn't hers. She was going to love him, and he was going to be her son. That's how we know it's important, that we find a way to love and mom and be the aunt and the nosy pastor. Because Jesus set the example. It's important for you to have a child, and it's important for this child to have a mom, whether they belong to you by birth or not. Who needs you to mom them today? Who do you need to say thank you for being a mom? Grab some extra chocolate on your way out. Make sure they get it. Run to HEB and go, oh, wait, mom, and get flowers. Call somebody. Send a quick text. Start praying for your daughters and the women in our community that will be women who raise our community, who will be faithful and strong and fierce and nosy. As a youth leader, before I was ever in ordained ministry, I had groups of girls that I discipled. And it was very humbling, and it was beautiful that people trusted me with their kids. And when the girls would come to me, and even the boys, would come and say, I need you to pray for XYZ. And I'd say, ooh, I can't. Why not? Because I always pray that you get caught. Like, that's the mom prayer. Do you know what I mean? I want you to get caught right before it's too late to turn back and just far enough in that you'll learn your lesson. And that requires divine intervention. If that's what we do, ladies, if that's the best way we step into momming, start right there. That we start praying and looking and being. That we're raising up generations of people who know the Lord, love the Lord, bless the Lord, and know that the Lord loves them. That we learn how to love each other by the way Christ loves us, that we see him as not just the Father, but the Creator, the parent who gave birth to creation. The perfect example of sacrifice and love and mercy and correction. Moms, ladies, thank you. We celebrate you, we bless you, and I pray that you know the favor of the Lord always. And that your children and your children's children, whether they were born to you or given to you, live and are shaped and are filled with all that you have poured out into them. Will you pray with me? Lord God, creator of the universe, the power and the spirit that gives life and breath. We call you Father, but we know that the creative power in you is so much like a mom. The Psalms and the scriptures talk about how you long for Israel and to gather the chicks under your wings. You love like a mom. You are the best example of what a mom or a dad should be. So, Lord God, make us more like you. Bless the women in our lives who have raised us and nurtured us and cared for us. Give us strength, wisdom, courage, vision to return the favor, to be loving, faithful, courageous sons and daughters. Let us remember the time that they took us into their homes so that we know the time when we take them back into ours. We love you and we bless you, and it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Praise to the Father and the Son, and with the Spirit they are one, united by a common love, they are family. Oh, Savior, come and make a home with stubborn hearts of sin and stone, made humbled by your kindness shown. Lord, have mercy, you became our transgression. oceans to give a kiss of peace. Lifted high upon the cross, you did a dream. For all that is broken, your heart was torn open so that we could be an unbroken family. Father, receive your wayward child, untamed and fully reconciled. You mend our hearts and leave them wild for your glory, your glory. You became our transgressions to give a kiss of peace. Lifted high upon the cross, you did a dream. So that we could be an unbroken family, undivided. Undivided. Nothing can separate us now, reunited. There is no height, no depth, there's nothing else undivided. Nothing can separate us now, reunited. There is no height, no depth, there's nothing else that we could be an unbroken an unbroken family, so that we could be your unbroken family.
Let's pray. We offer a special prayer for mothers, the day we remember, the day we celebrate, the day we give thanks. God of life and love, we give you thanks for this new day. We give you thanks for the rain and the restorative power as it comes to cleanse and nourish your creation. And we're grateful, O God, for all the ways your presence is made known to us in great and small ways, whereby we are reminded of your steadfast love for us and for all people. And on this day of celebrating your love, we give you thanks for those who have given us life. Though we may call you Father, let us not forget how often mothers embody your steadfast and relentless love. We praise you, O God, for your gift of motherly love, both gentle and fierce, both strong and humble, both kind and true. For mothers who have joined you in heaven and whom we miss dearly this day, we give you thanks. for mothers who work day and night to raise and care for their children, we give you thanks. We also remember those mothers who labor at this task alone. May we, your church, remember to uphold all families through our life together. For mothers who have lost a child to death and must carry on, we ask for your mercy. May we all sustain these mothers in their time of need and answer your call to reach out to them in compassion and love. For women who are new mothers and those who are expecting children but are not quite mothers yet, we praise you. God, for the joy and anticipation of new life, grant that we never forget our duty to uphold these growing families, that in our shared life together, we all may hear the call to be your disciples in this world. For all the women who longed for but never had children of their own, we give you thanks. These women have been living examples of your love and grace as they have answered the call to nurture and care for others. God, we also pray for the mothers who have failed to live up to the call of motherhood. We believe you are a God of healing, and we remember that we all stand in need of grace. Where we cannot forgive, Lord, give us strength. We praise your name and lift all mothers. We ask that you bless them, encourage them, and hold them close. Lord God, we come into a time of prayer where we confess our sins, our brokenness. Our own failures. God, I pray that we would be a people who turn to grace. Who press into grace, who let go of shame, who let go of the idea that we can be perfect. God, we forgot that there are moms who do all we can think or imagine, who give, who serve, who sacrifice, and still worry they haven't done or been enough. God, would you give them eyes to see the way you do? Would you help them to celebrate their victory in being faithful? God, you tell us to come into the throne room with courage and boldness, to ask. Big things, little things, to make our needs known, to trust you. Not just that you will answer our prayer, but that you want to hear it. That you want time with us where we talk and then we listen. And that we offer our hearts to you. So God, as community, we come and we lift those in our community who need your healing hand, who ask for intervention, who ask for strength, grace, and care. For Norma and Luis, for Marilyn, for Julian, for Jason, for Nida and Zach. For Mary, for Don and Donna. We lift to you Ben Kay and Dwayne. We offer prayers for Carol and MJ and Marianne. We lift to you Ed Payne and Judy. Gary, Jan, Loretta, Letty, Catherine, for Robbie and the family of Bob Hanlon. God, for those who prepare for a new season, those approaching graduation, those looking at the next thing, who are moving into places of greater risk, greater independence, greater joy. God, would you remind them that they never walk into the new season alone, that you are with them, that we are with them. For those who struggle with addiction, Lord God, would you deliver them from their oppression, from that sickness? Would you put the exact right people in their path that they would receive the care and the help that they need to be made whole? For those who struggle to believe that their circumstances can change, who feel trapped in an endless cycle of sin and brokenness or lack, would you remind them that you are good and you give good gifts to your children and you make a way where we can't see one, that nothing is outside your scope or your power, that there is nothing outside your heart. For those who look to see answered prayer, and where they have heard not this, instead they hear no. God, that you always have something better, something right. God, would you pour out the abundance of heaven? Would you teach us to give all that we have so that none would have need? Would you give us eyes to see those who need to be loved and seen, God? Just help us see. We get so busy walking through the day, doing what must be done, what we're responsible for, and we miss the opportunity and the ministry of interruption. The beauty of the unexpected, the unplanned, the inconvenient. If there are prayers that you would like to lift this morning, I invite you to use the Mentee link, that we can share and pray together, that we can carry one another's burdens, that we can share each other's joys. For my mom, Victoria, and my sister-in-law, Anna, Lord, hear our prayers. There are prayers on your heart that you would like to call out. I invite you to do so now. Make sure you speak them loudly so that we can hear and share together. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. God, for those things we don't know how to give voice to, the things that are raw or vulnerable, they feel precious and private. We invite you in to search our heart and our spirit, and we trust you with those things, those people, those circumstances. God, teach us to love the way you love, to speak words of life, to encourage, to bless, to walk in victory and healing and strength, to believe that we are a people empowered by God. To remember that we have the fullness of the Holy Spirit within us to be someone else's miracle, to be someone else's blessing in the name of Jesus Christ. We give you this day, this time. We offer these people to you that we have lifted. We ask for your favor, your blessing, and your peace. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. And now let us pray as Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It's this time that we worship God by bringing our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. You'll have seen on your seat a little slip of paper. I invite you to take a moment to write one way that God has blessed you and to bring that forward as part of your offering. That when we offer gifts to the Lord, it isn't just our resources, but all of who we are. When we make covenant to be a member of the church, we promise that we will give of our time, our talent, our giving, our witness, and our testimony. This one way to say, just in this last week, this is how God was real and active in my life, and I give God thanks. That's our witness and our testimony. And then each week we gather those up and they're published on our webpage so that the world can see, the community can see that we are looking for who God is and how God is active in our lives and in our community. And it isn't just a good idea or an intentional piece. This is so John Wesley. This is the heart of Methodism, that we give of ourselves, that daily we ask, how is it with my soul? How was I closest to God? How is God closest to me? And to live into that. It's part of who we are, and it's part of what we bring as our gift. So I invite you to come and to bring your offering to the Lord. Thank you. Lord God, take these gifts. Bless them, multiply them, do with them infinitely more than we could dream or imagine. For the good of your name, for the good of the church. It's in Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing our closing song.
He is for you. His face shine upon me, be gracious.